I'd like to also introduce Dr. Kei Takahashi, who is a visiting scholar here with us at the Center for Islamic Studies at the GTU. Grateful for our colleagues at Sophia University who first made the introduction. Dr. Takahashi has been here almost a year and has now extended, so we're delighted that he'll remain with us for another 6 months at least. He is a research fellow of the Japan Society for the Promotion of Science. He holds a PhD in area studies from Sophia University and an ME in literature from Keio University in Tokyo. His research interests include Sufism and tariqas, saint veneration in Islam, and Islam and modernity. His current research topics are on Sufism in the West, and he's conducting research on Sufi communities in the United States. His topic today is Islam in Japan, a foreign culture in a homogenous society.
Thank you very much. First, I would like to especially like to express my sincere gratitude for the staff of GTU, and especially Professor Dr. Jiwa for providing me such great opportunity to talk about this. I was dreaming about talking about here. Yeah. Okay. So, but I must mention that I'm not specializing in about this topic, the Islam in Japan. So my talk will not be so so analytical, but more kind of informative. And also there's another reason that actually this research on the Islam in Japan is still infancy, and with very limited scholarship available, even in Japanese. So I think, of course, there's still the number of Muslims are very few, but even much more than that, the scholarship itself is very small. Okay, so anyway, I will divide my discussion into three parts. So the first to begin is I will provide a background information on the Muslim community in Japan. And then next, I will go over history of Islam in Japan, and paying attention to both the Muslim community in Japan and also the scholarship on Islam in Japan. And in the final part, I think I will talk a little bit about the issue of the Islam and the Japanese identity. So namely, that how the Japanese today view Islam in relation to their own culture and society, and how they are treating the Muslims accordingly. So some people talk about me that there's no Islamophobia in Japan. Well, I'm not sure about that. So maybe I will talk about this issue in the last part of my talk. So let's proceed about the general information of the Muslims in Japan. So the Muslim population in Japan is estimated at approximately around 110,000. Which constitute only 0.08% of Japan's total population. And the majority, 100,000, are Muslim immigrants with a variety of ethnic backgrounds, while the remaining 10,000 are ethnically Japanese people. And among these ethnically Japanese Muslims, nearly 9,000 are thought to be spouses of Muslim immigrants who converted to Islam when they married. So as for the Muslim immigrants, they account for about 5% of the total population of foreigners residing in Japan. And the number of foreign residents itself is very small, only 2% of the total population of Japan. So the Muslim immigrants constitute a minority within the minority in the Japanese society. So about the national origins of Muslims in Japan. So the Muslim community in Japan is actually ethnically extremely diverse. So Muslims living in Japan came from nearly 100 countries all over the world. Well, but there's some large groups there. So the largest group is Indonesian, and then come the Pakistani, Japanese, Bangladeshi, and also Malaysian, Iranians, and Turks. And as for there's also Muslims from Arab countries, with the Egyptian constituting the majority. So about the Muslim communities in Japan. It is said that there are 80 mosques standing throughout Japan today. And apart from three state-sponsored mosques, those mosques sponsored by Turkey, Indonesia, and Saudi Arabia, all other mosques have been founded and supported by either local community of Muslim residents or student groups. While the majority of Muslims in Japan are Sunnis, but also they are Iranian, and they maintain their Shi'i community with support from Iranian authorities located in Japan. And there is also a minority groups like an Ahmadiyya, which they have community, and they count around 200 members in Nagoya. And I heard also there is an Ismaili community in Japan as well, but the actual status is unknown. There's no research conducting these minority groups in Japan. And also there are some international Muslim organizations that are also active in Japan. The most active group is Tablighi Jamaa, a Muslim missionary organization originated in South Asia, and which has operated several mosques and local Islamic associations. And there are also the Gulen group from Turkey, which is also active in Japan, and they engage educational activities, and they operate language schools and international schools. But as far as I know, there are still no Sufi communities in Japan. So I will show you some pictures of the mosques in Japan. Maybe you can have some imagination of the Muslim community in Japan. The first mosque, this is a Kobe mosque. This is actually the first mosque founded in Japan. And it was founded by Indian Muslim merchants living in Kobe. The Kobe was a big port city, and there was a lot of foreigners who were visiting there. This is a kind of community-based mosque. The next one, Tokyo Jami, is probably the largest and the most famous mosque in Japan. And this is a 100% Turkish government-sponsored mosque, and the imam is also being sent from Turkey. But, it's not only for Turkish people, but actually most of Japanese Muslims living in Tokyo are gathering here. So other mosques are much more smaller. This Ichinowari Mosque, this is the first mosque founded by Muslim newcomers who came to Japan starting from the late 1980s. And as you can see, the building was converted from a small apartment. And many other locally supported mosques have been converted from other facilities such as houses and small shops. But however, today, several communities have their own new mosques constructed. So Gifu Mosque is, I think it's a good example. As you can see, it has a very beautiful building over there. So construction of such new mosques by local Muslim residents visually indicates the establishment of Muslim community in Japan. So now some of the communities have the resources, and they can now have enough money to build their own mosques in Japan. Okay, so I'm going to talk about history. So before going to talk about history, I would like to mention about some periodization. So probably because of their low numbers, the lives and the communities of Muslims in Japan have attracted little attention, even from the Islamic studies scholars in Japan. But however, the lack of awareness of Islam in Japan does not necessarily mean that the Japanese people have had no interest in Islam and the Islamic world. Looking back in history, there have been several instances of increased interest in this religion in Japan. This interest has also affected the development of both Islam and scholarship on Islam in this country. According to Tanada, he is one of a very few experts on Islam in Japan, and he said that Japan has thus far witnessed three major booms of Islam, and now the fourth boom is here. So following his periodization, I will go over history of Islam in Japan. So the Japanese contact with Islam and the Islamic world was actually quite recent, which started in the mid-19th century, after Japan gave up its isolation policy and started to build a relationship with foreign countries. The substantial communication developed after Japan's victory over Russia in 1905. So this year is a kind of turning point in the modern history of Japan. A small Asian country's victory over a Western power was cheered by people of Asia and Africa, and attracting the attention of activists who were struggling against Western colonial powers. So many Muslim activists also approached Japan, hoping to utilize Japan's strength for the worldwide pan-Islamism movement. So there was also an expectation shared by these Muslims that the Japanese as a nation would convert to Islam. So these two interesting pictures below are taken from a satirical magazine titled Mullah Nasruddin, published in Georgia in Caucasus in early 20th century. And both pictures focus on a Russian Tatar pan-Islamist whose name is Abdul Rashid Ibrahim, and who visited Japan and tried to gain support from Japanese politicians. And the left one, illustrates the dream. As you can see, the man on the coach is sleeping, and the dream, his dream, that one day this Abdul Resht mission finally bear fruit, and all Japanese converted to Islam. So that you can see the Mount Fuji in the back behind, and the Japanese maybe samurais with a sword in their hand and saying something, maybe Shahada or Takbir. I'm not sure. So, such kind of dream, was shared by these Muslims. And on the right side, this is also the same magazine. And this is also Abdul Rashid Ibrahim talking with a Japanese woman. And he commented in this picture that, according to him, Japanese ladies, even though their faces are not covered, but they never behave against the morals of Islam. Or is it true? I'm not sure. So, So such kind of strong expectation was shared by Muslims in after the Japan's victory over Russia. Many Muslims believed, it's a kind of one step, to Japan become the Muslim country. So, if Muslims abroad gave Japan the eye like this, so what was the Japanese view on Islam during this year? So the victory over Russia promoted among Japanese intellectuals and political leaders pan-Asianism. This is the idea that Asia should unite under Japan's leadership. Although pan-Asianism turned out to be an ideology justifying the Japanese military occupation of Asian countries, but the idea of the unification of Asia attracted many Japanese intellectuals in those days. And these intellectuals emphasized values and ideas shared by various Eastern traditions and attempted to reconcile them. And it is in such an intellectual context that early scholarship on Islam developed in Japan. So Islam fascinated a segment of Japanese intellectual circle as a religion that originated in and spread throughout Asia. Probably the most widely known Japanese Islamic scholar from this period is Toshihiko Izutsu, I mentioned to show the picture, who first encountered Islam in the interwar period. And he compared Islam with other Eastern traditions, and his analysis on Islamic philosophy and Sufism deeply reflected the ideas of Eastern philosophy. The perception that Islam shared values and ideas with other Eastern traditions, or specifically with Japanese tradition, was also held by Muslims. A few Japanese converts even attempted to promote the so-called Japanese Islam by reconciling Islam with Japanese beliefs and customs. For example, I gave two examples. The first person is called Ippei Tanaka, who converted Islam in China in 1924. And then he presented the idea of syncretizing Islam and Shinto, a Japanese folk belief. He was actually born in a practicing Shinto and Zen Buddhist family, and he did not give up his former religious practices after conversion to Islam. And his idea was probably modeled after Islamic Confucianism in China, to which he was greatly attracted. Another example was Gunpachiro Ariga, who attempted to reconcile Islam with both his Shinto belief and the reverence for the royal family of Japan by identifying Allah with a Shinto deity and preaching respect for Mikado, the Japanese emperor, along with the prophet Muhammad. But however, their visions of promoting so-called the Japanese Islam were in a way naturally never crystallized. So then comes the first Islam boom in Japan. So during the war period, it started with the Japanese invasion of northeastern China. The Japanese government actively sought collaboration with Muslims and promoted scholarship on Islam. In its policy on Islam, which is called Kaikyo Seisaku in Japanese, Kaikyo means Islam. Japan aimed to placate Muslims in Japanese occupied areas such as northeastern China and gained support from Muslim leaders for Japan's war in Asia. A multiple state-sponsored Islamic societies were found in this period. And it was also during the war period that early scholarship on Islam greatly developed. Multiple research institutions were established, sponsored by the government or the military, to conduct research on Islam and the Islamic world. So some pioneering Japanese Islamic scholars, including Toshihiko Izutsu, worked for such institutions during the war period. However, the first Islam boom in Japan ended naturally with the defeat of Japan in 1945. So Islamic societies sponsored by the government were all disbanded. And also the scholarship on Islam was also discontinued with the dissolution of state-sponsored research institutions. The findings of the wartime research have long been neglected by post-war researchers. So the second Islam boom started in the 1970s. The Japanese attention to Islam and the Islamic world re-emerged during the 1973 oil crisis, which exposed Japan's heavy dependence on Gulf petroleum. And the oil crisis and the following political incidents resulted in Japanese people's growing interest in the Middle East and, by extension, Islam and the Islamic world. So this second Islam boom enhanced the development of Japanese scholarship on Islam and the Islamic world. So like a university department and institution for Middle East and Islamic studies have been established one after another since the early 1980s. For example, the first Islamic Department of Islamic Studies in Japan was created in 1982 at the University of Tokyo. And in 1985, the Japan Association for Middle East Studies, the first academic association for Middle East Studies, was founded. This association now numbers more than like 700 members, so it's not very huge, but there are more than few number of researchers in Japan. And once again, the state support has played a role in the development of scholarship. Since 1988, the government-funded large projects on Middle East and Islamic studies have continued to be carried out. So in short, Middle East and Islamic studies has become a burgeoning area of research that has been relatively well-funded for a field in the humanities ever since the 1980s. So maybe this is probably one reason why some students are attracted to this field today. So you are interested in the foreign culture. So why don't you come to the Islamic studies? Yeah. And virtually you can cover all the area around the world, right? Yeah. Yeah. Okay, but this second Islam had no direct impact on the Muslim community in Japan. Above all, the Muslim community remained extremely small throughout the period. The number of Muslim residents in Japan in 1984 was, for example, estimated at around only 8,000. But it was after the 1990s that Japan witnessed a rapid growth of the Muslim population. The first instance was the economic bubble of Japan between the late 1980s and the early 1990s, when a significant number of young men from three countries, Pakistan, Bangladesh, and Iran, came to Japan to seek well-paid jobs. So incomers from these three countries initially received visa waiver arrangements from Japan. Moreover, intermarriage with native Japanese produced a large number of newly converted ethnically Japanese Muslims, mostly women, who constituted the majority of the native Japanese Muslim population. The Japanese government changed in immigration policy in the early 1990s has resulted in the rise of Indonesian Muslims, including many women, coming to Japan as in-service trainees. So intermarriage with the Japanese is also visible among these Indonesian Muslims. So have a look at the line graph on the left. It shows the number of registered foreigners from Pakistan, Bangladesh, Iran, and Indonesia. So, but how? So, please look at the year 1989. I think you know there's no dramatic increase in the number of the population. It's kind of strange. So, do you know why? Why it's not there's no data on that? But this is because the most of them entered Japan as a tourist and stayed as an undocumented workers. So they are above all, they received a visa waiver arrangement. So they didn't have to register. But as for the Indonesian, they received visa. So you can see their number went up from the early 1990s. And an increase in Muslim residents additionally brought about the mosque construction boom. So while there had been only three mosques in Japan by the end of the 1980s, the number of mosques really went up in the late 1990s. As I stated earlier, today there are more than 80 mosques standing throughout Japan. So the bar chart on the right clearly shows its transition. Then comes 9/11. So the incident once again stimulated Japanese attention to Islam and the Islamic world and creating the third Islam boom in Japan. Middle East and Islamic studies witnessed significant development during this period. But it should be noted that a large-scale research project, which is called now Islamic Area Studies Project, started in 2006 and continued to be carried out till today. Well, it changed the name last year, but anyway, it's continued. And this is a huge project, and I think the most Japanese academics have been either directly or indirectly involved. Moreover, as part of its activity, Islamic research centers have been installed in several universities. And the Sofia University, which university I came from, now also have a center for Islamic studies. Well, it's the same name as us. Yes, yeah. And actually, I started my academic career here, there, as its postdoc researchers. So it's created kind of, jobs, for the new young researchers there. This is a web page over there. So, but unlike the situation in the US, 9/11 itself did not necessarily create anti-Islam sentiment among the Japanese. Above all, for many Japanese, it's a problem between the US and the Middle East. they're not directly related to Japan. But however, the situation started to change when Japan responded to the US call for the so-called war on terrorism. Perhaps the incident that has had the most lasting effect on the Japanese view on Islam was the invasion of Iraq in 2003. So to retighten its alliance with the US, the Japanese government actively supported the invasion of Iraq and aligned with the US military actions in Iraq. So actually Japan sent their troops to the Iraq to support the US army. So Japan's active engagement in the invasion led some radical groups to identify Japan as their enemy. And these groups started to kidnap and murder Japanese civilians in Iraq and now in Syria. So actually I was in Cairo studying there in 2003. I remember the days. So all the Egyptians were, before that, very friendly to me. Maybe someone say, oh, you are Japanese, maybe you are now, Japan is much stronger than the US. Maybe Japan can beat the US or something like that. But in 2003, the Iraq war, they found out, oh, Japan is also the ally of the US. Well, it was a reality before then. Yeah, so something, the situation changed. Anyway, this in turn provoked a fear among Japanese people that terrorist attacks might take place on Japanese soil in the near future. So although such attacks have not happened in Japan thus far, fortunately, but the heightened sense of crisis prompted the Japanese security agency to conduct mass surveillance of Muslims in Japan. The surveillance was revealed in 2010 when internal police documents were leaked online. The leak revealed that the police had conducted mass profiling of Muslims and surveillance of mosques across Japan. After the leak, a group of Muslims sued the government, claiming that the police actions were illegal. However, in May 2016, actually last year, the Supreme Court ruled against the illegality of the surveillance, claiming that it was a necessary measure to protect Japan from international terrorist attacks. So while there is no update on the matter after the closure of the case, there's no new news about that, but mass surveillance and profiling of Muslims are thought to be ongoing because the court decision virtually gave the Japanese police permission to monitor a particular religious community. Okay, so while treating these domestic Muslims as would-be terrorists, but interestingly, Japanese government is also reaching out to Muslims abroad as would-be consumers. So having set a goal of attracting 25 million tourists from abroad by 2020, the year when the Olympics will be held in Tokyo, the Japanese government is now taking measures to increase the number of foreign visitors to Japan. One of the major targets is Muslim tourists, whose numbers are actually quickly growing. An increase in Muslim tourists visiting Japan and a rising interest in Japanese businesses in the Muslim markets have created a rapid growth in the halal industry in Japan. So in response to growing demands from businesses, halal seminars and events are frequently held throughout Japan. A number of halal certification bodies have also created. So some people expect this is a fourth boom. So this boom will promote mutual communication and understanding between the Japanese and the Muslims. But at the same time, still other questions whether such an intense focus on halal is really a step in the right direction. So you take the halal certificate, put your item, and say the Muslim. So is that the understanding of the Islam, right? So also the credibility and even the necessity of such halal certification have always been questioned by some Muslims. Moreover, there are a group of Muslims who are critical of the halal industry itself, dismissing it as an exploitation of their religion for commercial use. Well, it's natural. So actually, if you Google in the halal and Japan, so you can find 100,000 pages now. But I will also take some pictures, show you some pictures about that. So this is a web page of Halal Expo Japan, which is taking place for, I think, since 2 or 3 years ago. And this year, they started a Muslim fashion show in Japan. So, and it says that the next expo will be held in Tokyo in November. So if you are interested, maybe you can go there, you can set your tour in Japan during that period. But actually, these groups are not so much, Muslim association are not deeply related, mostly Japanese corporation, and in Indonesia and Malaysian, companies are related. Also, another issue, it's related to myself. The Sofia University also opened a halal cafe, a cafeteria, in the last year. And, which is called the Tokyo Halal Deli and Cafe. And it is said that some other university in Japan is following. Actually, I checked the number of the Muslim students, international students at Sofia University, and it said it's only 50. Students over there, so not so much many. So, but their aim is obvious. They are trying to attract more students from abroad, including Muslim countries. Anyway, so since I'm going back to Japan this weekend, so maybe I will go there and try. Okay, thus far I talk about the history, and I actually checked the literature on Islam in Japan, I found that there is surveillance on the Muslims in Japan. And some people say there's no Islamophobia in Japan. But I wondered, oh, really, is that true? So maybe this is a Islamophobia. So the last part, I will talk about this issue. So what's this surveillance means? I think this is actually not directly we can call it Islamophobia, but more related to the Japanese identity. So anyway, as in other parts of the world, where the Muslim live as minority, one of the major underlying issues Muslims in Japan continue to address today is how to bridge the gap between Islam and the larger Japanese society. So Japanese Muslims, especially those who are ethnically Japanese people, are struggling to reconcile Muslim identity with Japanese identity. And the attempts at adapting Islam to Japanese cultural norms have always been also being gradually made in some local Muslim communities. And it must also be noted that, as I mentioned earlier, such attempt was already made, though unsuccessfully, in pre-war Japan as an attempt to make the kind of Japanese Islam. But however, today, in contrast to the attempt by the Muslims in Japan, few attempts have ever been made to reach out the Muslim community on the part of Japanese society. So police surveillance has revealed that Japan has seen Muslims with rather deep suspicions. But intriguingly, such Islamophobic rule against domestic Muslims is coupled with an enthusiastic welcome extended to Muslim tourists coming to Japan from abroad. So perhaps this seemingly contradictory view on Muslims directly reflects Japan's irresponsible reaction to political and economic conditions. So economically, we want the Muslims coming to Japan, but politically, they are dangerous, so we must do something. But however, this is not only, I think, not only the reason. Maybe such a reaction also typify more generally the images the Japanese have of self, the Japanese, and others, the foreigners. So let me briefly elaborate the basic nature of the Japanese identity. So one of the major features of Japanese culture is a dichotomy of the Japanese and the foreigners. So Japanese identity is molded on the premise of sharp distinction between these two categories. So the underlying narratives concerning Japanese identity shared by the majority of the Japanese people today is that the Japanese are a single race and constituting a society that is both ethnically and culturally homogeneous. The foreigners, on the other hand, are viewed as completely different people who have no access to Japanese culture or its society. So as the majority of Muslims are non-Japanese, Islam is also considered a foreign culture that is incompatible with Japanese culture, even though Islam is logically understood as a world religion that is open to all humankind. And because of the emphasis on the singularity and the homogeneity of the Japanese, diversity within the society and culture has mostly been ignored. So it must be noticed that in reality, the Japanese are not single race, nor do they share a homogeneous culture. They are actually, multiple ethnic minorities and foreign residents living in Japan. However, these people are marginalized in Japanese society, making them generally invisible to the majority. So there has also been deep-rooted discrimination against minorities and foreign residents within the Japanese society, especially against Koreans. But such racial issues, again, are rarely discussed in the Japanese public sphere. So I think the legal sanctioning of the mass surveillance of Muslims mentioned earlier may also be understood as another form of the neglect of minorities in Japan. And tellingly, in contrast to the quick reaction of the foreign press about this incident, the Japanese media has been blatantly silent on that discriminatory ruling against the minority. Actually, there's no media coverage on this legal sanctioning of the Muslim surveillance. In Japanese, I checked that, but in Japanese, I couldn't find any, news about this. So, in a way, this Islamophobic rule against Muslims in Japan should be discussed in the context of the Japanese identity issue and the status of minority and foreigner in Japanese society in general. So, finally, I give you a very interesting poster put up by Japanese police in Tokyo. Okay, so this poster. This is a poster, and what is this poster about? This is said in the top of that, they said, we are asking information on kind of Airbnb. And below there's a written that we need your information in order to prevent terrorism and to host Olympics successfully. Well, but look at the people written around that, you know, corner, side. Is this something, you know, very specific, you know, features, I think, from this? No. So I think this poster typically embodies somewhat complicated views the Japanese have on foreigners. So they are principally, I think, welcome, because they're Olympics, they're welcome. But actually, many Japanese are fascinated with foreigners and their cultures. But at the same time, these foreigners are viewed with fear and mistrust because of their outsider status. So, but also it's interesting that all the people of all colors are illustrated. I think you can see the white and the black and the brown, all the people illustrated, indicates that all-inclusive nature of the category of the foreigners. So, in a way, the Muslim immigrants are first and foremost categorized as foreigners before being regarded as people of a particular faith. So the promotion of halal industry and the police surveillance maybe reflects such complicated view the Japanese about foreigners in general. So although the negative image of Islam is also pervasive in Japan, so there's a news coverage and many people, if you ask, maybe say Islam or terrorism. But they are actually not, attack on the, specifically for the Muslims in Japan. Maybe this is because such kind of image were more generalized as something related to the broad category of foreigners. So in this case, I think that my conclusion may be, it's difficult to make conclusion, but I can safely say that there is still, in a way, no Islamophobia in Japan in the specific sense of the meaning. Thank you very much.